to the Startup Grind.
Without any further ado, I'd like to welcome the CEO of Atlas Networks, Jordan Ritter. Come on up. Tell us just about, tell us about the Ivy, you know, the Ivy software. You know, how, what was that vision? Like, where did that start? And kind of tell the audience, like, first what it was, because they don't know, maybe not know the details of what that looks like.
So I've started 5 companies, done it a bunch of times, and before I did this last one.
Oh, perfect.
Oh, there you go.
Oh my goodness, that's amazing.
Endor voice, that's my Endor voice.
So I started a bunch of companies, and every time you get some things right, and you get some things wrong, and you learn, and then you do it again, and you do the same patterns, get some things right, and some things wrong. And when I came up here, and I was lured up here, thankfully, I was faced with 2 problems. First one was working on something, probably the biggest thing I've ever done in my life, and couldn't talk about it. We needed to market ourselves, and we needed to market a way to attract talent, and we did that through culture and values. And the other part was this sort of recognition that, especially in the earliest stages of a startup, a software startup, I think it's true in most startups.
Yeah.
The most valuable asset you're building is not the tech.
It's not the IP and all that. Yeah.
The IP, it's not. The most valuable asset you develop is the people, the team. And I think most of us have had experiences with average teams. And average teams or mediocre teams or, you know, sometimes good teams can get things done and maybe not, but a great team is something that when you're a part of it, you've seen it, like, holy shit. Things sing. What makes a great team? And so the problem of coming up here was, I don't know anybody. literally starting over. And that's actually one of the things I love about startups is starting from scratch.
Yeah, yeah.
But this was a real challenge in order to go after this super big thing. And so with that sort of key insight that team's the most valuable thing, I developed an idea and a model to attract people that held that as sort of a central truth, knowing that no matter what, if you end up creating a great team with a capital G, there is nothing you can't do. And so the idea was expressed as Ivy Softworks, and there's a whole value proposition, a pitch to it, and a way to attract people away from the big Candyland corporations that folks work for these days with all these wonderful benefits and drone jobs that we're given and little swim lanes that we operate in. And we had to differentiate ourselves. And I'd always had this vision of, like, you know, that develop that asset and that resource deliberately, and so many great things come from it.
Yeah.
And that's what Ivy Softworks was.
And the when you started Ivy, was it, did you already know you wanted to work on the search aspect, or was that something that started to evolve within Ivy?
Yeah, so our company's Atlas Informatics.
Yeah.
There is an Atlas Networks, by the way, so I get,
oh,
I get confused.
Yeah.
Atlas is not an uncommon name. But that was the idea from the get-go, was going after what we're going after. But because we were in stealth and because I held a very, very strong belief in the importance of building great teams as a path to getting there uniquely, that's what we marketed, and that's what we launched ourselves as.
Yeah.
As an innovation studio. And the problem is, like in all startups, like, how do you deposition yourselves? How do you market yourselves? How do you help people understand what you do? A really hard problem. Everybody's like, yeah, you're an incubator, right? No. You're an accelerator, right? No. What are you?
What do you guys do?
what do you do here at Inatech? And what we do, develop people. but the right answer to your question is, yeah, it was always about Atlas. And this idea, the idea about great teams was that if you build a great team, and how do you do that is the critical question, then great teams have great ideas all the time. Like, that's 100% of the time side effect is you'll spend all this time crashing yourself in the crucible of building something great in pursuit of a worthy mission. And when you come out the back end of that, you'll have spent all your time building all of this stuff. And one day, someone on that team is gonna go, what took this thing? And we used it in this completely different context. And someone else in the room, because it's a great team, is gonna be like, yeah, what if it looked like this? And someone else on the team is gonna go, oh, I'm learning Ruby right now. I could spend a whole weekend just banging out a prototype. And everybody's like, great, let's go prototype this thing. Yeah. And they go build it. And they come back in on Monday. And you know, it's business now, right? So you got revenue, you got customers, and these guys and girls are excited. And they go to middle manager Bob, because by that point there's middle management. They go, hey Bob,
I got this
check. This cool shit we did. Isn't it amazing and glorious and wonderful? And Bob glances down thoughtfully and pauses, because that's in the script. And he glances back up and he puts his hands together and he goes, you know, great job, guys. Really great effort. But the business is the business and the product is the product. Go sit in your fucking corner. And they leave.
Yeah.
And they disintegrate. So if that's the most valuable asset you're building, why do we lose them 100% of the time, succeed or fail, in pursuit of building these businesses? That was the essence of the studio, was we're gonna crash ourselves upon the crucible of building Atlas, but on the tail end, we're gonna entrepreneurialize everybody we possibly can, because we know, having built a great team, that they will have their own ideas, and that, from an investment standpoint, is a real asset to keep around.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, so the
SoftWorks studio, right?
Innovation studio.
Innovation studio.
I don't know still.
It sounded good when you were developing, right?
Awesome.
The innovation studio. When you does it still exist, or is it still exists?
There's a corporate answer, a legal answer,
sure,
and a spiritual answer.
Yeah, I know corporately it does exist.
Yeah. Legally, it does not.
Yeah.
And spiritually, it absolutely does. And the intention is still there. And we are building a great team. And they do actually have their own ideas. And we deliver those ideas.
Yeah.
So at some point, Atlas becomes a business instead of a startup. And we will continue to develop folks in that way.
Yeah. Yeah. So the plan is still to continue down that path. And
Atlas Labs.
Yeah. Yeah. So why don't you do that? Why don't you give a short explanation of, you know, Atlas Recall, you need to explain that. It's not something you're just going to...
Yeah, it's some science fiction.
Yeah, there is some science fiction there, definitely. Yeah.
Atlas is a searchable photographic memory for all your devices and data. Problem we solve is that we have all these accounts, we have all these pieces of information spread out all over the place. The average U.S. consumer has got 138 accounts. If you bought something online, you sign up for an email account last 15 years or three, instant messaging accounts, social networking accounts, file sharing accounts,
sure,
services, apps, you have over 130 different places meaningful stuff to you is spread out. You have all these great search tools and they're equally as fragmented. So you spend all this time hunting for stuff. So it's a really great stat. We search two-thirds of the time, we search three or more times to find the thing that we're looking for. These devices, they see everything we see and do, but they're still dumb as rocks. They don't do anything we don't tell them to do. They don't save anything if we don't say save it. So what do? We save files, and we create folders, and we organize, and we tag, and we email to ourselves, and we text to ourselves, and we Facebook to ourselves, and like, oh my God, we're gonna lose all this stuff. These devices are always on, always connected. They see everything we see and do. Why don't they just save it all for us, right? Because we got the internet, it's infinite. It's where the internet we have cloud, it's where the internet lives, it's not full yet. Why does it just save everything I see?
Yeah.
That's a starting point. Where it leads to is it's actually learning what's important to you. And it looks like search in the beginning, but it converts very quickly to a device getting to know you in a way that your memory works. And it's going to start suggesting things to you and start doing things for you.
Yeah.
So it's some science fiction stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's being built as we speak.
It's in public beta. You can go download it today. Atlas.co.
There
because who has the time for the extra M?
There you go. So tell us some things about, let's go take, go back 5 years or 10 years. Mm-hmm. Talk to us about I guess that was sort of what, three? So three?
You can pick an arbitrary time. Yeah, just what kind of story are you looking for?
Yeah, so I mean, tell us like one of the ones you started from, just idea, like Jordan and Mike have an idea, we're gonna start this thing. Okay. Tell us one of the stories where you got started and you met some guy or some girl and said, hey, we're gonna start this thing because this thing does this thing. Tell us how you decided whether you knew it was a thing.
Good question. Let's talk about CloudMark.
Okay, CloudMark, yeah.
Which is the company I started after leaving Napster.
Can you tell us the first name of that company?
Someone's done his research. It's part of the story, so I'll tell it as I tell the story. I'm a nerd. It might not be obvious. I wear a dress up nice.
Oh, it's obvious.
Yeah, okay, great. I'm an open source software developer. Built a lot of stuff in the public domain.
Yep.
And in 2000, late 2000, early 2001, I was working on an anti-spam solution, which at the time, if you don't remember, Bill Gates famously said, we'll have this problem solved in 2 years. Not easy.
Yeah.
And no one was doing any machine learning in it whatsoever. So I was doing machine learning before anyone had popularized it, before Paul Graham had written a paper on it. And there was one fateful summer after I left Napster. I was just working on it over at my desk because it's my life. And my now ex-wife, because startups are hard, walked up behind me. She's a tech recruiter, so she's somewhat savvy. And she says, what are you working on? And I'm like, oh. It's the most amazing thing. There's like all this crap out there, filter spam, but I've really come across something new here and I'm building it and it works. It's predictive, it uses machine learning. It's amazing, I'm gonna open source, everybody's gonna use it. My ego's gonna grow 3 inches, it's gonna be amazing. and she's like, uh-huh. So it works? I'm like, yeah, it's amazing. It's got this cool technology, blah, 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 blah. She's like, so do you think people will pay for it?
Oh. That's a tough one.
Yeah, but I'm going to open source and it's going to be amazing and wonderful. And this is what I do. This is just me. And so she put her hand on my shoulder and she said, and this is a direct quote, no. You need to make me some money, bitch. Half joking.
Yeah, half, exactly. Now, half.
It made an impression. It didn't stop me, but... I started engaging people in conversations and realized, oh yeah, there is an opportunity here. I don't know what that looks like. My second startup experience was Napster, but I can't claim any real understanding of what it takes to build something completely from scratch all the way to finish. So I don't know, I'm gonna try it out. But I know you're supposed to look at what's in the market, what other technology there is, who my competitors will be, what's my value proposition, how do I deposition myself against them, I do all these things. So I built this little competitive landscape thing amongst some other stuff, and I categorized all the solutions in the market. There were 5 categories, crap, my stuff, and collaborative filtering. And there were only 2 in that category. Yep. It was a product called DCC, which is, for the nerds in the audience, just distributed SHA-1 signatures of emails, and the other one was called Vipple's Razor. Sounds interesting.
Yeah.
Occam's Razor, Vipple's Razor, who else is this Vipple guy? Turns out, he and I were IRC people on the same channel. We were operators of the same channel called Pound Pearl. We were both huge Pearl people. We've been idling in the same channel almost 10 years. His name was Hackworth. My name was No Carrier. And he didn't know me, and I didn't know him, but he was working on this thing. And so I thought, okay, it's IRC. If someone reaches out to you, you're like, it's fucking internet. Like, I'm going to, who the hell is this guy? So I spent like an hour constructing the perfect message. And it had a link to my white paper. And I was tailing my web logs when I sent in the message and I watched him hit it. And then he responded. He's like, that's really cool, dude. I'm down in LA. Just finished up a contract. Would love to connect.
There you go.
So brought him up. We met at the, I remember opening my front door to see him. His online pictures, he's an Indian guy, had long hair, like out of the 80s, like a poster child of the 80s, long hair and boots. He's bald. And I look at him, and I go, like, you don't look anything like your picture. We hug each other, and then I'm like, you don't look anything like your picture. And he's like, that's funny, dude, because neither do you.
Exactly.
And we spent the next week talking it out, like, collaborative filtering, that's people interacting to filter stuff, and machine sure. learning needs qualified input, and there's a reputation system behind this whole thing, and we worked it out after a week. And so we were like, okay, what are we gonna name this thing? And I think this is a problem today, it was a problem 18 years ago. What domain names are available?
Now, what year is this?
Oh, God, it's 2001.
2001, yeah, okay.
And I'm like, all right, fucking nerds, let's pick something already, because he had no ideas. I'm not a product marketing guy. I can turn a phrase pretty well, but back then, like, neither yeah. one of us had it. So I'm like, all right, cool. I'm gonna look up the Latin for anti-spam, and that was Sodalitas Eliminatatum Pergamentum, which literally translated means the Society for the Elimination of Garbage. And I'm like, let's call it sepsoft.com. I thought it was so clever. And I registered it, and the next day, he woke up, it was in the morning, and he's like, you know, I was thinking about the name. Yeah. I'm like, yeah, isn't great? It's like, so listen, let me tell you about Werner Vinge. Who's Werner Vinge? The yeah. guy authored The Singularity, a wonderful science fiction writer, and he's a badass math professor at Purdue, or I don't know if he's still there, but yeah. Super smart guy. He's like, he wrote this book, A Fire Upon the Deep, and in it, there are all these email, these intergalactic email exchanges, and like email, it has the router chain as messages are exchanged. And Vipul read one of them, saw the name Cloudmark,
and said,
"It's like, fuck it, I'm gonna register that." And he's like, "Listen, I've got this domain name I've been sitting on. I don't know what I was gonna do with it, but what do you think?"
That's Cloudmark. Much better than.
Way better, and you know, I immediately started thinking, oh yeah, like we're looking at email clouds, and we're trying to figure out that's a spam, and that's a spam, and that's a car, and that's a spam. Like, yeah, it'll work. So that's the story behind how we met, and you know, it was just this idea, like, let's collaborate and build something great.
I love the name of that.
Which one?
The long name.
So, Elitas Eliminate.
Yeah, yeah. I read that, and I'm like, holy crap, really?
Nerd.
So what did, in that experience, you hacked away at for a while, and you got a product, obviously, and...
We had users, right?
I mean, users, and yeah. So, your next one, what did you learn from the previous one to the next one? Not from NASA, but like, what did you learn from Cloudmark when you went into the next, what was the thing you took from that? Was like, what did Jordan say? Oh, I learned this over the last 2.5 years.
That's an interesting question, because the transition after Cloudmark was for atypical and maybe pretty standard reasons of founders leaving their companies. And like almost everything in my life, a serendipitous knock at the door, and I opened it, and ended up being CTO at Columbia Music, based out of Tokyo.
Yeah.
And if you don't know about companies in Japan, they're like an institutionalized form of socialism. It looks like capitalism, but these people have their jobs for life, and that's not going to change. And so if you're brought in as a change agent to rescue a 100-year-old music label, you have your work cut out for you, these people.
Good luck on that one.
Yeah. But the solution was to build an incubator within that company and start building startups inside of it. And you know, this seems to be my MO, is like, I'm okay with, you know, landing in a foreign land and developing a forward operating base and building operations out from that. Had its own unique challenges, no network, no connections, starting from scratch, corporate Japan. I would say that the critical learning, if you're forcing me to just reflect on that transition, I would say, after having done my first startup in tech, doing Napster, and then doing Cloudmark, which was one of my proudest cultural achievements, what I learned by that point was how to endure damage and have faith in myself at the same time, having now endured a lot of damage and having come out the other side of it alive and in some cases triumphant. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, that's something you can read in a book, have faith in yourself, and you can say it to yourself in a mirror 100 times, and it doesn't actually stick until you're forced and you're challenged to face yourself and adapt to yourself and circumstances. And without knowing, discover that you can actually get through it and maybe even become better from it. And so, you know, you're forcing me to reflect on that transition there. Yeah. I think that is what enabled me to land in a foreign country where I didn't speak the effing language, where no one at that company other than the CEO wanted me to succeed and still build a couple really successful startups and spin them out, which was a really fun experience. It really made me like a stranger in a strange land, a foreign expeditionary force where I understood risks and fears, but I was able to take chances and surrender to the experience and still battle through and win.
Your family, brother, sister, forgotten, you have a...
Only child. Until about age 18, and then I discovered I had 2 half-brothers.
Who's your best friend? You don't have to name his last name, just his first name.
I only have a few.
Just give me one.
Vipul is one of them.
Vipul?
Yeah, my co-founder.
Still?
He's like
still?
My brother.
Really?
Yeah.
Very cool.
I see him every month.
So if I called Vipul right now and said, hey, I'm sitting here with Jordan, what's the best thing about him? What would he say? Someday we're actually going to do this real time.
Call.
Oh, he's in Costa Rica at his wedding. His second wedding.
I was going to say, why aren't you there?
Because I work at a startup.
What would he say?
I probably recite what he unsolicitedly wrote on my LinkedIn profile, which is like, Jordan has a level of intensity and purpose that is unparalleled and unmatched. I've seen him plow through everything from raising money to building product to driving across the city. And fear, I think he uses words like fierce and intense and enduring. I think he'd say something like that.
If I called and asked him what was the worst trait, what would he say?
Yeah. That's a wonderful interview question, by the way, to all of you. Was, you know, reflect on a past job experience and then what is the worst part that a coworker would reflect on? If you have the empathy there to understand it, it's a good sign that you don't pass. you know, my relationship with Vipul is so loving, like a brother. We forgive each other on so many things. I think he might say the same attributes are Achilles' heel.
Yeah, they're two.
Too intense.
Too intense.
Yeah, and my growth has been around moderating that.
Yeah. So that's good. Good to know. So if you're going to start a company, let's just say you and I have an idea, right? We have an idea now. We think it's going to work. We have you and me and 3 people. We have a team of 5 that we've got a product hacked together, and we're talking to customers.
Matchsticks and scotch
right,
tape.
Exactly. So we were duct tape and baling wire. What are you going to focus on? What is the one or maybe 2 things that are super critical to getting these 5 people to the next step, which is, there's a lot of steps, but what are you going to focus on for those 5 people to push the thing forward?
So pushing something forward, you have to ask yourself what the goal is. Is the goal to endure as a great team? That's one possible answer. Another might be get to the next level, because startups are like massive multivariable step functions.
Sure.
And nobody's forever.
Yeah.
So, you know, if I reflect on the innovation studio and you know, the intent versus the reality there, no one lasts. Startups are huge, you know, diamond making crush machines, and they chew people. And you learn and you grow, but they're challenging. So what's the goal there? The goal is to get to the next step. Sometimes it's about the team and sometimes it's not. And you have to be honest with yourself. But I would start the answer for myself around, and this isn't always the right way, but it is for me, start the answer around values. So what is the difference between a best friend, a great colleague, and, you know, the love of your life romantic partner? Other than the obvious differences, nothing.
Yeah.
Why? Because we share the same values, we believe in the same things, we disbelieve the same things. There's a natural fluidity and connection that's easy and simple and fun and engaging that is an edge that you need to plow through the hard moments, which are most of them. And so that's what the studio is about. It's like, okay, how do we hire for values? What are those values? Because they're different for everybody. And then the second thing, most important thing, especially in software engineering startups, if they're real startups and not like Lego photo sharing applications,
sure,
you're going to be doing something that's never been done before. So what you know is almost irrelevant. Your ability to learn new things is probably the more important skill.
Yeah, so focusing on that learning.
So we call it capacity for mastery, culture, capacity for mastery, and then craft or skills. Focus on those first two things in the earliest stages of the startup are the most important. Later stages,
skills.
It's different,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. The skills are, as you go forward, become more important. And where are the things that, you know, just looking back and say the last 2 years, right? You know, you've raised a bit of money. You know, you've got a product out the door. Beta or not, doesn't matter, it's still a product. What have you learned about being a CEO that was a big surprise for Jordan? Like, what was the thing that said, if we were just sitting around having a beer and I would say, Jordan, what over the last 12 years like been a big surprise for you to just like even knew that you could even do, or two, you're really crappy at it? Like,
yeah. I love that you asked this question, especially because there's some people in this room who are gonna hear this for the first time. But it's honest. I built a lot of teams, all of them, engineering, product,
sure,
ancillary functions, sometimes sales, but one thing I know is tech and product.
Sure.
I went into this thinking I was building that same team, but that's not the team that I built. The team that I built was my executive team. And I've actually never done that before.
Yeah.
I've done it in pieces.
Sure.
I found a great CFO, I found a great CEO, when I handed the reins over to someone who knew the next set of steps. But I've never actually constructed an entire executive team before. And I think I'm having experienced so many mediocre and average teams, I think I'm having a great executive experience. But I reflect all the time on the fact that I've never hired a senior management team and managed them before. And you know, half of them are sitting in this room.
Sure.
And I've never said this to any of them. But that was the big surprise.
Yeah.
It was like, oh, I don't actually fucking know what I'm doing.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is all these things that I,
which is okay,
that I know, and that are principles and values, and,
sure,
and I have faith and confidence in my ability to adapt and learn.
Yeah.
But that's what I didn't know, and what I didn't really compute when we built the studio and converted into the startup. I was like, oh yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
The team I built was this other team.
Yeah, forgot about that.
Yeah.
What is the you know, in the product side, when you're building a product, right? You've done this many, many times. When you're starting off and you have the skeleton of it, right? So you have the concept. You probably have a few feature sets. You kind of know what's going to be there. Like, who is the most important person to hire? Let's say that it's not you being the leader because you're a technical guy. Let's say it's me who's non-technical, I'm a business guy. Like, what is the...
Depends on the business you build.
Yeah, assuming it's a software,
okay,
right? I ask this question because I know there's several people in this room that are bumping across this problem right now. So they're non-tech leaders.
They're entrepreneurs.
Trying to figure out how to build a product even though they've kind of built it. They just don't know how to technically put the pieces
to deliver it.
Yeah, the ones and the zeros.
Yeah, this is a huge challenge.
Yeah. So if you could give them one or two pieces of advice, what would it be?
Wow, these are great questions. Let me think for a second.
Okay. You can can that one. I'll go to another one. I don't know. Because that's you need to ruminate on that a bit.
Great question.
So also, again, this in the development of a product, right? Let's say you are now have product very similar to where you are now, where you actually have customers using the product, giving you feedback, fixing things, adding features, subtracting features, all the normal stuff you do in a software. What is it that you would tell your product manager to focus on?
If I have one.
I'm just assuming it's you. So so what would you tell that product manager to focus on?
Like pain. Focus on pain.
Who's pain?
Customers.
Customer pain.
It's so easy. So there's three phases. Prove the tech will work, prove people will use it, prove people will pay for it. You hear these pithy, somewhat trite sometimes statements, like always center on the problem you're solving for the user, and like of course. You read it in the book, and again, it's sort of like the difference between knowledge and wisdom is experience. And until you have the wisdom, it kind of doesn't always translate.
Yeah.
Ever. But I'd say focus on the pain, and sometimes that pain changes. And if you're solving a legitimate pain point for somebody, and it's really hard to focus on pain when you're in that first phase of proving technology will work, because sometimes the problems you're solving don't have to do with customer pain, they have to do with making it work.
Yeah.
So it's easy to get stuck in that.
Yeah.
And it's hard to detect when the right time is to transition, and most people do eventually transition, and almost everyone in my experience that does reflects, boy, I should have done that sooner.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, so it's a hard one. And I don't think anyone ever nails it. But as often as you can, once you've gotten into that second phase of what will help people use my software versus does it work, is what is the actual pain point that you're solving for them? How do you make, more pie in the sky people would label it, how do you make the world easier to use? And how does your software fall into that?
Yeah.
Like, what is the daily or regular or valuable problem that causes frustration or is an unmet need or an actual pain point that you deliver on? And if you can center all your messaging on that, you can center the feature set on that, there's 1,000 other things that can go wrong, but that won't be one of them.
Yeah.
And like your product, very simple,
sure.
Very obvious pain point. People steal my shit off my porch.
Exactly. Like, that's easy.
I gotta make it work. Different set of problems.
Yeah.
But
the problem is easy. Yeah. I 2 years ago, that's what I said, right?
It's
easy.
Real soon now.
So, go back to your question about non-tech leader. What's he? What's the one or two things he?
Or she.
Yeah. Or she. Yeah. What do they need to be focusing on? Like, it's a hard one, right? But
abstract answer I've given in the past is one of the best things that you can practice and try to get good at is setting expectations. I say the whole of unhappiness in the world descends from a common root of a mismatch in expectations. Expect it to go one way and it didn't the other. When you're starting a company, your own expectations are important to set. When you're bringing people together, setting their expectations is really important. It's harder to do if you've never done it before. You don't know what to set people's expectations around. But there's all these common problems around, people's mismatched expectations of what they're capable of versus their own visions of themselves. So there's people who want to be CTOs, who want the title and have all these ego attachments to it, even if they don't say it. That can be a real risk, and if you're good at managing expectations about what the opportunity is today versus down the road, that's important. The other really important piece of advice is as a CEO, entrepreneur is a slightly different frame, but if you're thinking of yourself as I'm in charge and I'm responsible in the long term for this thing, you have to think long term. And that's another one of those knowledge bits that doesn't mean shit until you've actually had to figure it out. And what I mean by it is, you're hiring people, which is like the most important thing you do in the very nascent stages of something.
Sure.
You have to think about, especially around equity. What does it mean for this person to be here for 4 years? I can read in a book where I've seen it before that there are all these different stages and nobody's forever. At some point you drop out either because it doesn't suit the phase that you're comfortable with, or you burned out, or your life changed, or you got hit by a truck, or you had a kid, whatever, right? Things change, it always changes.
Yep.
You have to be thinking in the longer term. So the two things together, managing expectations with a, you may not know where you're gonna be in 4 years, but you know that you need to be thinking about what it takes to get 4 years or 5 years down the road, and setting people's expectations. What does this phase look like? And it may not involve you in the next phase, or you know, it's okay, or we need to be in dialogue about that and things change, but doing a good job managing expectations and thinking further ahead to
live. Yeah, you know, I would say the thinking forever is, that's a common misconception with a startup, because you think like we become partners, you know, 51-49, we think it's forever. Mm-hmm. It's never forever. It's never forever, and it's just never forever. And I think we make decisions assuming and thinking it's going to be forever because we've known each other for six years. We work together.
Optimists.
We're optimists always. So why would it go wrong? And I think that's the, horror
why
stories.
Does it matter?
Yeah, yeah. Well, it will. It's just a matter of when.
You don't have to make a judgment statement about it. We will part ways. It does not mean something went wrong necessarily. Yeah. But if you change the frame and the mentality that nobody's forever and sometimes it's okay, then that removes a little bit of the charge in setting expectations around that eventual outcome.
Yeah, because we know it's going to happen. We just don't know when.
100% of the time.
Yeah, we just don't know when or why.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. I just think for entrepreneurs starting their company, that's something that everyone should remember, is that piece. It's like nothing is forever. Your partner, your CTO that you've grown up with as a kid probably is not going to be forever. It's just,
right. And there's,
and you may leave. As a CEO, you may leave.
No, it's guaranteed. You're going to die. Someday, the ride will be over.
Exactly.
So one way or the other,
yeah.
Plan for it.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. A question that I ask every single guest is, how did you earn your first dollar that wasn't from a relative?
I was cleaning condos, scrubbing toilets, and making beds at the
awesome.
Age of 13 for a company called Suncoast Resort Rentals in Tampa Bay.
Very cool. So you were cleaning
toilets.
At 13.
Yeah.
Good for you. That's good. I haven't heard that one. Heard a lot of weird ones. That's not one of them. That's more normal. That's more, you can understand that one. What is the, what's the things that you you like to do with your team? Like, what are the things that you like to do as a team building exercise that you, maybe, you know, you're a geek, I know, but that's fine. What are the things you like to do? What's the, for your
what
team?
I love for
with the team, love? with the team. I'm like, okay, what do we do with the team? What are the things that you like to, you actually enjoy? Like, I really look forward to X. Like, part of my thing that why I do this is because this is really enjoyable for me.
Your quality time.
Right, this is quality time, right? This is fun for
that's
me. So this is my 3 hours. So, yeah.
I get it.
So what is it for you and your team? What things do you like to do that...
I'll answer that with an anecdote that's recent and released to someone in the room, more than one person in the room. I love collaboratively working with people. And what does that mean? I'll give a picture. I had the honor and the privilege of being invited to do a Quora session in the last month or two.
A what?
A Quora.
Oh, okay, Quora.
Q-U-O-R-A.
All right, yeah.
And... You know, the way it's set up, if you don't know, is they give you a time window, and you wait. They give you questions ahead of time, and then you get some more, and you can choose, but like you gotta write.
Yeah.
You gotta get it done.
Yeah.
And I worked a startup, by the way, so I don't have a whole lot of time to prepare for these things.
Exactly.
So I'm sitting in this room, and I got my VP of marketing and a couple folks from this wonderful PR team, and I've never done this before. I've never answered a Quora session. I certainly never approached this, but it felt right in the room. We put
up on the wall.
Yeah, put the Quora session up on a monitor that everybody could see, And we all started, we started answering questions together in a Google Doc. So we're all typing into the same Google Doc at the same time. It's my voice. They're helping me copy edit it, and I'm talking because I'm, you know, the way my style of writing is a little bit more erudite and academic than my style of talking. And so we would talk about it, and then people in the room collectively together were literally typing words apart from each other.
That's cool.
Doing it together for a whole 3 hours, and that stands out as an abstract thing, one of my favorite things to do. I love getting in a room and riffing with my executive team. I love getting in a room with engineers and designing shit and figuring it out together. It's when I'm at my best, and when I'm at my best, those are, I think, amazing experiences for everybody else in the room. That's my favorite thing. Building stuff, constructing stuff, synthesizing in unison with other people.
That's very cool. What is the piece of advice you would give the second time entrepreneur who's had a success?
After a failure.
No. He's had a success. His first startup was a success.
Okay.
He's now starting she or he is now starting her second startup. Mm. What piece of advice would you give that person, knowing that they're being successful? And I'll frame it a bit more. I'll give you some more frame it more. They're technical, so they understand the technical side. They're technical. They understand the technical side of it. They have some business knowledge, so they're fairly well rounded. Maybe that was why they're successful. Maybe not. But they were successful in exiting, and they felt like they did a good job, and now they're starting their second company. What is the piece of advice you would give that person?
Well timed.
Very timed. That was very nicely timed. Whoever did that one. Was that you, Suzanne?
What did I say? The one piece of advice. Oh my God. What do you say? I'll tell you what I wouldn't say.
Okay. Well, let's
just start with that.
Start with that. What would you say?
Balance is bullshit. When you're in the business of stealing worms from the early bird, you show up earlier, you work later, set your expectations appropriately.
Yep.
You're successful, you think you're going to keep that quality of life that's about to go away. You better be on board with that.
That's some good advice right there.
Okay.
Right there, that's good. Right. I mean, because here's what I've seen and actually experienced personally, because my very first startup was successful. It was really easy. So it gave me rose-colored glasses. It gave me rose-colored glasses. Mm. Like everything was so easy, because I didn't know any difference. It's my first startup. How would you know? Right? So the piece of advice is saying, it ain't like you think it's going to be just because the last 3 years have been so rosy.
You know, I still think, and maybe you can correct me here, but if the outcome was successful, it's never easy.
No.
I don't think it's ever easy.
Well, there's no startup that's easy, period.
Right. So success is still possibly the product of a hard, complicated journey, and usually is.
Yeah.
And so, really depends on what kind of person you are and what you took away from that experience as figuring out what to advise you on the next one. But I don't know that you necessarily come out of a hard but productive experience thinking it's going to be easy the next time around.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd like to think not, but we certainly have this cliche. What I do tell people though is, because I'm a nerd and I love science. You don't learn shit when you win. Neuroscientifically, you create precisely zero new neural pathways
when you win.
When you succeed. It's only when you fail that you build new neural pathways. In other words, it's only when you fail you learn. So if you seek the easy and the complacent and the safe, you will not grow.
Yeah.
And evolutionarily, you will die.
Yeah. Tell that to the caveman. Where are things that you see your industry going? Like, where do you see search? Like, what are things that are interesting because you're an engineer, you're deep into it. What are things you're looking out and seeing that, that would be interesting to other people, you know, starting companies? That give us some forecasts, give us some insider knowledge that you think could happen in the next 2 to 3 to 5 years. Give us some nuggets of golden juiciness.
It's going to be hard to say this objectively without sounding self-serving, because I'm doing what I think the answer is to that.
Sure.
We got big data. We got all this data everywhere, and we think it's wonderful. It's glorious, wonderful data.
Yep.
Makes the signal-to-noise problem worse. Its fragmentation makes it harder. And so I like talking about this wonderful movie. I love this is new. I'm gonna try it out here. But you ever seen the movie Her?
Sure.
Fucking amazing movie. Yeah. Really not about tech. Really about social impact and personal and intimate impact and human social relationships and fucking fascinating stuff. We have lost our embarrassment at leveraging the word AI. apparently, it's you know, the marketing people have, thanks by the way, co-opted the term, and it's now
sure.
like innovation and
yeah.
synergy. It means nothing
sure.
almost.
Yeah.
But that's true AI, and the question is, what does it take to deliver her, to allow the seed of her to germinate? We have all these people building AI solutions, and we're also slinging the word context, and we're in the age of context. A good friend of ours, Rob Scovel, likes to talk about that, wrote a book about it.
Sure.
And we're high on the smell of our own AI farts.
Right? Exactly.
It's like, oh my God, it's a fucking AI agent that can
yes.
calendar things for me.
Yes, exactly.
Oh my God, really? This is a far cry from her.
Yeah.
I got Waze on my phone.
Sure.
I'll be sitting in the airport when it tells me it's time to go to the airport. I'll
yeah.
be standing at the gate when it tells me I got 5 minutes to get to my destination and I'm already where I'm at. And these things fall short all the time. We got context, we got big data, and big problems associated with that. And we have this vision of the future where we make the world easier to use by allowing these devices to know us. To truly know us.
Help us make decisions.
Help us make decisions, help us do things, make the world easier to use. And I think these are all interesting areas that are talking about problems and pain, but they're all these very narrow solutions that end up becoming part of the problem because they're still fragmented. And so when I say what I think is interesting, I think it's this effort that right now is largely the purview of a very small select few of large companies. How do you bring together all that information? Like, I think a critical problem is we get more apps and more devices and more services and more things that are taking from us, and we don't know where our stuff is and we don't have control over it, but it's mine and it's my perspective and my universe. How do we put you back in control, and how do we leverage that in a way to truly improve the world, the way we interface with the world?
Yeah.
So that to me is interesting. Like, of course, you know, there's iterative improvements. Like, we're going to use AI to detect faces in imagery, and that's cool. It's, you know, it's a feature.
Sure.
I'm not sure it's a pain point, but there are cool things you can do with it.
Yeah.
But I think the next undiscovered country is, you know, a new breed of platforms that bridge all the intentionally created moats and silos to block you off and lock you in order to enable something like her to germinate.
Yeah, to actually help us make our life easier, make decisions, et cetera, et cetera.
In a complete way.
Yeah, yeah. And just a couple minutes, guys, we'll open up for questions, so feel free to start putting things in your head. What time is it?
5:00.
Look at that, just
winning.
Where does Jordan want to be 2 years from now? Like, what do you, it's not like oh, I want to be living in an island or something like that, right? Like,
no.
Like, not that you want to do that. I kind of already can guess what you want to say, but where do you want to like be in the ecosystem of technology and what you're doing in the industry? Like where does Jordan want to be in that space? Do you know what I'm trying to say?
Because like kind of, I can't tell if you're asking about my company.
Well, your company and you were there's a probably pretty darn close thing there, right?
It better be.
Yeah. So
but on a personal level, my answer would be very different.
Yeah. So on a company level is what I'm trying to get to is like where does that end? Where is that going to be in 2 years? Do you think it's going to be in the direction moving towards her, or is it going to fracture off and do something else? Do you have a feel for where the company will be in 2 years?
I know where I want it to be. 2 years is a tough one.
No, it is. It's a long ways. Yeah, 24
it's
months
an
is
eon.
Yeah.
Right, a lot of shit happens in 1 month.
Yeah.
24 is crazy.
Exactly.
I like saying to folks, you know, what's your 3 to 5 year prediction? Bullshit. That's what my 3 to 5 year.
Exactly. Because that's what I know.
Because anyone else who tells you they know is lying. I just don't know.
So go 12 yeah. months out, Jordan. Go 12 months out and say, you know what, this is where I think we could be in 12 months.
Well, that part I know because I'm pitching. I'm
okay.
not raising
exactly.
money right now. Look, these devices are stuck in the Stone Age. They don't do anything without you telling them to do something. And their notion of recommendations are still shitty. Everyone wants to tell you how amazing they are, and they're just full of shit. They'll get up on a stage and tell you, and if you don't know, you'll buy it. But if you do know and you look at them, you're like, wow, this is not there yet. I think if we are able to stick on plan, you'd be able to install Atlas on every device you have, like you would Dropbox or Evernote or email or whatever.
Sure.
And live your life in a very different way digitally, where you no longer have to worry about where stuff is. You don't have to file or save. You lose the battery anxiety equivalent of data anxiety.
Yep.
You don't need to save and file stuff. That's one paradigmatic shift that I think can happen by the end of the year. The other is we start to build trust with people through the system, able to understand, this device is able to understand my needs, what I'm doing in the moment, and semi-intelligibly, which is way better than anything else today, suggest things I need in the moment before I have to go hunting for them.
Yeah.
That's two. And the third thing, and this is something we're playing with right now, is we can start to, with this notion of what's important to me, before we get to her, which is further.
Yeah, it's further down the road. Yeah.
This notion of what's important to me, now we start delivering value around the pain point of mutual relevancy. You and I are working on a project together. We've got about a dozen files between us, but only that one and that one is important to you, and only this one's important to me. The system knows we're working on this stuff. But it knows what's important to you, and it knows what's important to me. So when I go search, and when it starts suggesting things, it just starts suggesting all three of those things, and not all 12.
Yeah.
Sounds really simple. I think we can get there by the end of the year.
Yeah.
At least easily by the end of the year. And we call that Atlas.me.
Atlas.me.
Which we also own.
Yeah. Coincidentally. Questions, guys? Feel free to raise your hand.
Yeah. You mentioned with Ivy Softworks and was Innovation Studio, you were in stealth mode for a while.
Yeah, a couple years.
Yeah. So at what point do you decide to unleash your idea?
That's a good question.
You know, what kind of things did you have in place before you took that trap?
There's no prep. I mean, you can look back on it and say I could have made different choices and I could have prepped myself, but you know, when you're leading and you're moving quickly, you have to both be good at recognizing opportunities and seizing them. So it's a great question. You know, in retrospect, I can say we could have come to it sooner, always. But there was a point where we had solved the problems of making the tech work and a point where we needed to shift our focus towards what problems, what pain could we actually solve for users? There's all sorts of variables, you know, expectations at the board level, at the investor level, expectations with the existing employees and executives, and you go through a transition like going from a studio, which is a different value proposition, to being a startup, which is a harsher experience, right? There's no book I've found that talks about that. Other
setting expectations, recognize nobody's forever, and people can live in choice and make different choices on any given day. That was super challenging, but at the end of the day, you know, I think the advice is when you see you've got something wrong or you see you've got an opportunity, if you're a startup, you're in the risk-taking business, embrace it, right? Because you'll build new neural pathways if you're wrong, or you'll advance the business if you're right. And sometimes they're not mutually exclusive. But the thing to optimize for is recognizing those knocks on the door and opening the door quickly and leaning into it, modulo common sense and experience and knowledge and the counsel of people you trust. But that transition, you know, for what it's worth, was a hard one for us. For a lot of people, and I had a choice. I could not tell people about it. So I don't know that many people, other than the executives in the room, I don't think many people know this, but I knew at the beginning of the year, of last year, that we were gonna do that. And at the executive level especially, and this is again sort of one of the things I reflect on, I'm like, oh, I've never done this before. Oh, interesting, could have seen that one coming. Didn't learn from it, was I could have not mentioned anything to anybody and we could have continued down the path. And I think that's actually a common choice as CEOs, entrepreneurs, but CEOs who are entrepreneurs will tend to not want to rock the boat because enough fucking shit you're dealing with. Like, I don't want to create problems for myself. I want to keep things as stable as possible. But, you know, the mismatch in expectations is the root of all unhappiness in the world, and it eventually happens. And the deeper that mismatch, the harder the impact. So the risk that I took and still to this day live up to, try to live up to, is to accept, to live in truth, allow people to live in choice and accept the reality of whatever comes from that, but be true to my own values, and one of them is about being straightforward, honest, and direct. And so I told all the executives, I had this whole offsite at one of my executives' house. He's sitting over there in the fourth row. And we had this whole meeting, advisors and executives, and I said, look, we're gonna make this change. We're gonna transition, and it's a different value prop. We're not gonna sit here and just invent ideas and build technology and then spin them off to become businesses. We're gonna go all in on this baby, because holy fuck, if we deliver on this. Like, this is the swan song, the opus, magnum opus. Not everybody was on board with that, and that was super scary. Lost some really valuable, capable, excellent team members who, given the choice, made the choice not to convert to the harsher experience. It takes guts, it takes wisdom to know that it's better to take your hits up front. You'll have more time to compensate for them than to delay and defer, at which point the gap grows so big that the explosion is much worse. But just some insight in there,
Next question, guys. Go ahead.
So you talked about building your executive team and how that was the first time you had to do that. Like,
completely, yeah.
Is that something that just kind of happened out of necessity, or is it something that you planned and you were like, time to do that, and this is kind of necessary to go forward, and at what time did you decide?
So it was at the very beginning of the studio, so the value prop being, let's build this great team. Great team's values, great team's capacity for mastery, but you don't know what you don't know, and you need people who know to teach and guide the people who don't know. It just doesn't magically happen on any meaningful timescale. So with that problem to solve, that pain point in mind, we need someone to help run the business, we need someone who understands product and marketing, we need someone who understands design, we need VP of engineering, I'm CEO, therefore we need to find a CTO. Like, there are all these different roles and capacities to build the, and we had a preconception of four different, completely different areas of technology that we chose to merge into Atlas Informatics because they were greater together as a whole than the sum of the individual parts. And you need senior leadership for that. So I had the backing to do that. It checked out, it made sense. It computed, and we built that team very, very early. It was hard, like, you know, just go out write a check and then the great people show up, it was a slog, as it always is, to find your best friends and the people that you want to suffer with and
hang out with.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
But yeah, we planned ahead of time for it.
Chase.
Can you talk about your support network? Like, do you have a coach, mentors? Like, what? Like, when your back's up against the wall, who are you leaning on?
I did most of what I did in my life alone, and that sucked. I probably risked failure more often as a result. Thankfully, I didn't die, and thankfully, I learned quickly-ish.
Sure.
When I came up here, I had a different experience. And it's this interesting serendipitous story, recognizing knocks at the door. Needed to find office space. Eventually found this really cool hip office space half a block away. And the owner, the business owner that we would be subleasing from, a guy by the name of Paul Kim, fantastic, amazing person. Ratio was the name of the company that owned it, or leased it. Went over to get the keys at his office, hit it off in a hot second, and really great. I'm like, wow, you're awesome. You need to find an HR firm. So did my thing, plowed through, interviewed a bunch of different firms, ended up meeting Shannon Swift of Swift HR. And holy shit, she's amazing, and her whole company's amazing. You're awesome. And then I'm like, I need to hire this executive team. So I started talking to executive recruiting firms in the area and ended up meeting Paul Freed of Herd Freed Hearts, also an amazing firm. And also an amazing guy. And he's sitting there and he's like, remember us having coffee? We're about to close the deal because it's all about relationships. And he's like, hey, have you ever heard of this thing called EO? No. What's that? He's like, well, it's this cool community. Cool community, I don't know, that's not how you pitched it, but it's a cool community called Entrepreneurs Organization. And there's other versions of it. There's EO, there's YPO, there's, God, I don't know, there's like 1,000 of them now,
yeah,
it
yeah.
seems.
Yeah.
Right? But this particular community is made up only of entrepreneurs. If you're an executive, you can't be in it unless you run the place because it's a distinctly shitty experience that, you know, even your partner cannot understand unless they too have been CEOs. And so the only other people who could possibly understand what you're going through and sit without judgment of your experience and maybe be a boon to you are the people going through the same experience. And pull back the curtain, turns out Shannon and Paul and every other effing person that I had met in my high bandwidth interactions with everybody were in EO. And you go through this training, in order to be in that group. And the curious thing was, I had sort of gone through a personal evolution over the last 6-7 years, since I turned 30, basically, and learned a lot about what is framed as personal development. But if you utter the phrase personal development to a professional executive, it's anathema, and you're like, I don't have anything fucking wrong with me. I don't need personal development. I need a coach. It's the same shit, by the way. Marketing. And you go through this process, you realize it's the same thing, just by a different name, and you know, you meet, and you share experiences, and you do it in a safe type of structure. And wow, did I have a different experience. I've had imposter syndrome my whole life, and in some ways still do. The best of us, I think, do. Who weren't total assholes. And here I was amongst a ton of other people having the same shared experiences. And, you know, are they coaches? No. Do they serve that value and that sounding board? Yeah. And deliberately, they're not allowed to give you advice in the context of the forums. They're only allowed to recount their own personal experiences that might match that you can draw from. Very subtle, but non-judgmental frame. It's like, here's what I have to offer. We have these shared experiences. Having that made a huge difference. Now these days, sorry for the long answer, but I think this is useful. I have advisors. I have people whose counsel I keep. And many of them up here now. And one of them, who is now my independent board member, he's a phenomenal person, Ben Elowitz. little person. He gave me one really simple frame. He's like, Jordan, every day your view is going to slightly change of what you need and what you think the organization needs. But on any given day, maybe monthly, maybe quarterly, maybe semi-annually or annually, you should write a little matrix. On the y-axis, going downward, what do you think those critical needs are of the org and of yourself? And then the x-axis is coach, staff, executive, board member, advisor, consultant. Because you can get what you need from any one of them. And always keep, and it might change. Like in the earliest stages, you don't have the luxury of getting an investor who is everything you ever dreamed of. You're gonna have to find what you need elsewhere. But being deliberate about what your needs are and what you think the org's needs are, and then having that lens of where could I get it for the stage that I'm at, really, really valuable. So do you need a coach? Maybe, maybe not. Like with that lens, you might decide you don't. And there are these communities where they're not framed as a coach, but you get to experience the harshness of what you're going through other people's experiences, and that can have a profound effect.
Quick question, last one.
And a quick answer, I promise.
So you mentioned how like phones nowadays are just nothing but like a collection of sensors and they broadcast information. You know, that's even enough to entice people to pull it out, you know. Even in like a 30-minute meeting, you can't have something without going off, you know. So my question is that when you're describing, you know, Atlas being this novel sort of a machine learning thing where your device knows everything about you and your device is already able to monitor you constantly, I mean, it doesn't sound like her, it sounds like HAL 9000. So the question is what is the future of AI from your own perspective? Like, do you think that AI will ever be truly displacing us as human beings?
Yes.
Short answer, yes.
He hates the short answer. There is a profound amount of dialogue and debate about whether AI is going to help us or kill us. And I'm trying to remember his name. Eliezer Spakowski, something like that. Bizarre name, but preeminent guy. Got all this wonderful stuff online you can read in particular. You know, he takes the viewpoint that goal-oriented AI, which is, you know, goal-oriented behavior without, you know, all the biochemical reinforcements and negative influences, will eventually just optimize for the goal, and the goal, anything gets in the way of the goal is going to get killed, if it's capable of killing. I don't necessarily subscribe to that, but I think we're a long way from HAL 9000. I like to take an optimistic view of the future. We can teach children that are developing to become good human beings, we ought to be able to teach other intelligences that are developing to be empathetic or care about other things other than just getting goals done. Yeah, I highly encourage you looking up Eliezer because there's, you know, it's so much fascinating writing. And it's not a short answer. Maybe I should cut it here. There's a fascinating anecdote.
Keep it short.
Here we go.
Keep it short.
In order to prove that AI can outsmart human beings, even though we don't have an AI that can outsmart a human being, he proposed an experiment. He's like, call it the AI box. AI can get out of any box you put it in. And he said, in order to prove that, we're going to jump on a chat channel. I'm going to play the role of AI, and you're going to play the role of my gatekeeper. And we're going to spend 2 hours there. We're not going to share this. You know this?
I've heard the story. Go ahead.
Okay. This is amazing.
It's quite good.
There are all these people who are like, I can keep the box. Like, I'm not going to let you out. And he's like, you're wrong, and let's try. But no one can share our interactions, and I got 2 hours, and I can say anything I want to say. To convince you to let me out. Everything's fair game. And then you're gonna authentically, incredibly say what the outcome is, but you're never gonna share this conversation. And this guy's like, fucking go time. I'm not letting you out. 2 hours later, he lets him out. Craziness ensues. uproars happen, and Elliot's here very smugly says, I told you so. And someone else is like, that guy's a stooge. I'm the real deal. You're lying. And Elliot's just like, want to go again? 2 hours later, lets him out of the box. If you watched Ex Machina, that movie, that is the AI box problem right there. People don't recognize it as that, but that's what it looks like.
That's interesting.
Now, did that bot try to, did that bot kill someone? Yes. Did it do it because it hated people? No. Did it do it because there was a goal it wanted to achieve that got in its way? Maybe not. Like, its goal was to learn more.
Yeah.
So I don't know. But what I'm proposing is not that. What I'm proposing is
not that.
Something that's like 10 stages before that, but is the next stage beyond where we're at today, which is this thing sees everything I see and do. In fact, Google sees part of what you do, and Apple sees part of what you do, and Microsoft sees part of what you do, and it doesn't serve you. It's stuff they see, but you don't. So Atlas isn't about taking something from you, it's about putting you back in control and giving you that complete picture of you, and letting you share elements of that complete picture of you with other human beings you know. And then ultimately, being able to share that with an intelligence that's not a human being, because you trust it, because it's built up your confidence and faith that it knows you, and piece by piece will start to make the world easier to use for you. And that to me is a her vision, not a I'm gonna murder you vision.
Exactly. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah.